Good afternoon.
Welcome to our session today.
According to the agenda of the conference, this session will be conducted in Mandarin Chinese, but you have the simultaneous translation service, so please use the headsets.
As you all know,
Is lasting for a while, but they are faced with a fiscal cliff in the future, and they all focus on China, while China needs financial reform, which makes it more important.
So our panel today
is most powerful and authoritative voice from the Chinese financial sector. On my left hand, is Mr. Dai, and he was surrounded by journalists just now. He's the chairman of the National Council for Security Fund,
and
we also have
the
chairman of Bank of China, which is the most open-up bank in China, and also Mr. Fang, Xinghai, Director General Office of Financial Services Shanghai. And also we have the UBS
colleague,
and also Mr. Li Daokui,
economist
in Tsinghua University. We also have Mr. Zhu Ning, the Deputy Director of Shanghai Advanced Institute of Finance. He is the rapporteur for our session, and he is also a thinker. And he will comment on our session today. So now we start our discussion. According to the agenda of Summer Davos,
what
has to do with the currency market, the diversification of our bank deposits, as well as how can the enterprises gain capital. And we will also talk about the strengthening of our financial regulation. The first question will start from my left hand.
People my age would know him.
Well, the younger ones might not know. In 1993 to 2012,
Mr. Dai, at that stage of financial reform, actually did a lot of overall or general arrangement
and push the forward the reform at that time. Many people think that reform after 1993 to 1994
is not fast enough. Of course, there are some reforms in the commercial banks
and internationalization of R&D. I want to ask Mr. Dai, do we need some top arrangements for China's next stage financial reform? Thank you.
杨副总让我讲讲金融改革的顶层实际问题。
So, Ms. Yang, want me to talk about the top design or arrangement of the financial reform? I'm not really in a position to say, but I want to share with you some of the focus of China's financial reform currently. After 2 decades of assisting and development, the banking sector in China has transformed from a poor technological state to a more advanced state. So where are we now? Our economy is the second largest power in the world. We have a 7% of growth potential, and our trade accounts for 1/10 of the world total. And we have a 1.8 trillion net debt, second in the world. So China's finance is closely linked with world finance. So financial reform, apart from the current aspects, should focus on the interest rate of RMB and internationalization of RMB. So there might be four breakthroughs for us to do. First is the market-oriented interest rate reform. I suggest that we can make use of the Shanghai interbank lending rate. We now have 8 such kind of types. We hope that there will be more financial institutions involved with more transaction volume before we mainly make up for the position. We want to do more now. And I hope that the Central Bank of China can reduce the spread between the interest rate of loans and deposit. I also suggest that we issue a large amount of deposits.
There
should be a differentiated interest for a large amount of deposit and small amount of deposit. And for medium and small-sized banking institutions, their flexibility of the interest rate can be better.
这是我第一点建议。
So that's my first suggestion. The second suggestion is that while improving, we have to make more efforts in improving the financial institutions.
中小型的各类金融企业,
and we should develop financial institutions of all sizes.
所以我建议我们国家的
and let them provide differentiated services. Banks account for 90%, while the top five commercial banks account for 47%. So we have to consider whether we are going to develop a capital group or a finance group or an integrated
bank.
I think we should establish holding companies with banking, insurance, and equity, and securities services.
人保公司、保险公司也是这样
insurance companies,
原来证券公司也是四家国家银行为主办的后来通过兼并现在不是这样所以说这是一个意见这样子呢他们可以为我们的企业集团或跨国公司出售
In this way, they can serve better
for our enterprises and multinational corporations. And we also talk about service to micro enterprises. How can banks create conditions to serve the small and micro-sized enterprises?
And the institutional finance
is very important. We need to establish the new kind of a rural cooperative to serve the farmers.
And
another thing is
to
improve the capital formulation.
Now
the debt increase growth rate is much higher than the capital increase ratio. That means the risk in China's finance sector will accumulate. So I suggest that China establish a social or private capital reporting system to see the social capital in the commerce and industries to see where they are and how they are distributed. And we want to let the institutional investors to invest in the equity market. Currently, the corporate bonds are approved by NDRC, while commercial paper is approved by Central Bank. But we should standardize the procedures for corporate to issue bonds. In this way, can we push forward the internationalization of RMB? Another thing is the fund investment. However, from 1997 till now, we haven't managed to establish a equity investment regulation. So financial institutions not only provide its traditional services, it should also provide wealth management services. Another thing is that we should make breakthrough in capital programs such as internationalization of RMB. In
1996,
I represented Chinese government to announce the free conversion under current account. However, after the Asia financial crisis in 1997 and the subprime mortgage crisis in the United States in 2008, we should pay attention that we should approve more qualified overseas investors. Now it is only 20 to 30 billion. It could be increased to 8 billion.
And,
when the public companies announce that they have only 30 to 40% of foreign investments or stocks,
超过了市场就停止了，我认为就很快了。而印度在吸引外国资本进入股票市场，它是很大胆的。所以我们值得。India
is very bold in this move. And we also want
the domestic money to be invested overseas.
We want to expand the business of the cross-border RMB settlement.
Actually,
Chinese people cannot mix RMB with other currency to buy property. But actually, Chinese people also bought
houses
in other countries with foreign currencies. So that situation do exist. So after all, I think we're not that far away from the open up of the capital account. So we should make breakthrough in the market-oriented interest rate reform, as well as the institutional arrangements of financial institutions, and also the capital formulation, and finally the open up of a capital account. So if we can do the four things better, then the Chinese finance sector will see a new landscape. Thank you very much for giving us a broad picture. I think a specific question is that you mentioned the conversion of the capital account. Can they be achieved by 2015? With the economic and the financial reform, I don't think it's measurable by time. Because it is influenced by the international community. In 1996, we think that it may take us only 5 years to realize the open up of a current account. However, after the financial crisis in Asia, things changed. So we should look at the broader landscape around the world. However, China's finance sector does have a better self-discipline than before. We should be risk awareness and opportunity awareness to push forward the reform. So, as the former governor of the central bank, Mr. Li said that by 2015 we may have the condition to realize the open up of capital account. We want other panelists to comment as well. Mr. Li talked about the debt, the RMB, internationalization, etc.
I think
Well, the market-based interest rate and a series of changes in terms of monitoring or regulation would definitely have big impact on the banking sector. One important point is that the banking sector in China will transform faster and will segment faster, because in that situation, the pricing mechanism, the risk management would be different, so the banks would be forced to transform. This is a very important point and feature. And of course, there are so many different aspects when we talk about transformation. In the past, we provided a lot of loans to big companies, but in the future, probably we are more interested or motivated to support the development of SMEs. The secondly, innovation. Look at the banks in the European countries. When regulation changes, financial institutions are motivated to innovate. China still lags behind innovation when we talk about the banking sector, so there is potential here. The third feature is that we will definitely move faster
in terms of encouraging these Chinese banks to operate overseas. Big commercial banks will move faster in having business in foreign countries.
So when we talk about the trend,
of the banking sector.
First of all, transformation. When we transform, we have segments, further segments or differentiation. Some banks would focus more on their priority.
You know, now there is so much homogeneous competition.因为你没有市场化的环境，一旦利率、汇率这个市场化了，这个监管更加严格以后，各家银行都会找到自己的符合自己自身发展的定位，它去发展，所以转型。第二会加快创新，第三呢会跨国经营会加快。
好像
香港董事长呢是把整个银行业和整个中国银行未来呢都点得非常清楚了。我要问的再具体一点，您觉得中国银行要分化，那么也就意味着中国银行
要中国不是中国银行要分化，这个分化不得，我们还没有达到那个大而不能倒。
所以我们还不能把
中国金融机构、金融机构、
中国
银行。或者叫中国金融机构，在未来的竞争当中会分化。
没错，中国的银行要分化，那么就意味着是说，中国银行要和中国工商银行和中国建设银行要不一样。您觉得除了国际化之外，您还能怎么不一样？
我觉得因为中国银行的这个历史呢，是一个它是靠外贸起家的，所以我们叫贸易金融起家的。因为大家都知道，中国银行它是100年前成立的。
Bank of China
那么最初它是在
做广告的董事长，
最初都是在港口，上海、天津，是吧？广大上青天嘛，青岛等等港口发展。所以我们这个银行的一个很重要的特点是贸易金融。那我想，中国银行目前仍然是贸易金融全世界最大的一个银行，我们的国际结算量是几万亿这个美元一年，全世界最大的。所以我想这个特点是区别于我们国内其他同业的。那未来中国银行仍然会在贸易金融、供应链金融方面做出我们的特色和品牌。
多谢董事
长，我想顺着您刚才讲到的这个整个监管的变化大的趋势呢，再问一个更加细化的问题。我们也都知道呢，中国呢要会和这个全球的银行一起呢来进入这个巴塞尔三的这个大家庭，用巴塞尔三的框架来要求自己。那么这个对于已经充分创新的全球的欧美的这些银行而言呢，它是有它特别的含义。对于中国的银行业而言呢，因为中国的整个这个金融深化的程度，包括我们杠杆化，包括整个银行业的成熟程度和创新都还不够。我们在这样的前提下呢，就开始做这个八三的一些约束呢。实际上呢，有很多人有一些担忧。比如说，我们就讲一个特别实际的问题。我们如果是根据八三的要求呢，像要求有更多的资本金，但是呢，在中国我们没有资产证券化，或者是说我们刚刚国务院开了一个口。我们资产证券化呢，目前的这个额度呢是整个银行业资产的千分之一，它整个规模是非常小的。如果没有资产证券化，如果又在八三的这样的一个框架之下，实际上银行业能够腾挪的空间是非常有限的。董事长，您觉得你会大力在国务院层面推动资产证券化呢，还是你有别的什么高招，让你能够来在应对八三协议的同时，保持让你有足够的竞争能力和赚钱的能力？
刚才戴理事长说的非常好，就是我们银行业的资产的增长。
Very well. The bank asset increases very fast.
实际这个中国的这个八三实施以后啊，
Actually,
我觉得非常很有重要意义的一点，就是能够推动中国资本市场的发展。那么就刚才你也提到了，比如说资产证券化的问题，现在我们很高兴地看到呢，监管当局已经启动了。刚才代理市场提到的 CD 的问题，也已经进入到一个研究推出的阶段了。但这是监管，应该说是实施阶段了。那么当然这是监管部门的事情了。那么我讲的是国内的 CD， 其实国外 CD 已经非常普遍了，非常普遍了。我们已经在国外已经发了 CD 了，对，我讲的国内了。那么这个国内的，你知道国内的这个资本工具啊很少，补充资本工具很少。坦率地说，中国银行业的还是中国银行业的啊，这个资本的质量是很高的，因为我们都是股本金，没有太多，再加上一部分次级债，很少量的次级债，就这两种。如果说大的种类来讲，那么事实上呢，在这个资本市场的这个补充资本的工具还很多。所以在这个方面呢，由于这个八三的出台，一定会促进这个
Because
they will boost the development of the capital market in China. Does it
mean 我觉得现在压力不大, 因为我们的资本从事刚才我说了, 一个是核心资本的, 我们比较高,
first, the core capital ratio is very high, over 10% reserve ratio, but you can see the capital very fast. The total capital reserve ratio is also very high. So we are well-positioned. Currently, the pressure is not that high, but in the future,
按照过去中国的历史的未来资产, 贷款资产, 要快速的增长,
if the debt market grows very fast, but the capital market is not developed, then the conflict will evolve. Our hope is that in the next few years, the capital market in China will develop fast. That will help us solve these problems. So if you do not come up with the ways to solve this problem, then probably Mr. Li would have more pressure. Because if there is a more demand for refinancing, banks, then generally speaking, the market would be under great pressure. Now let's give the floor to another representative who can represent the market. You know, I take part in summer Davos quite often, and we always encounter Mr. Guo. Mr. Guo
haven't appeared in Davos after joining the securities organization.
So I think the duty is in Mr. Li's hands. For us observers, do we think, generally speaking, people think the security market is not good enough? What's the problem?
刚才你一开始起, 刚开始你讲的时候呢, 讲到了一个金融, 有点像身体里头的起搏一样, 心脏一样。 实际上金融它的这个功能性来讲更准确，我们讲的话像一个血液，如果我们讲一个血液的话，客观讲的话，它有一个排毒的功能，它还有一个营养功能，它还有一个再生的功能，它造成机体啊，相对于机体来讲。 那么严格来讲，人体的结构很美妙，那我们讲的血液来说，我们一直在想，就是说。 改革开放这么多年以来，金融市场走了二十年，风风雨雨走了今天，实际上是进步的。那么当然，你说现在的我们拿一些物理条件来讲，它的交易的这个交易的这种火爆程度啊，包括发行的那个节奏啊，还有一些个体的一些这个金融市场的，包括的交易的产品，还有交易的手段呢，都不够完善。实际这就是个问题，这个问题呢，就是呢，我们缺少一个。 完善的系统，这么一个金融的一个运营机制，同时这里头也包括相关的监管机制。那么客观的来说，有几个方面，比方讲这个，一个完善的金融市场的话，它应该是由多方面的这个金融机构或金融市场来组成的。 应该有证券市场，没有错，有债券市场，有money market，这货币市场，应该有期货市场，有外汇交易市场，有没有？我们有，但是呢不平衡，有的大，有的小。刚才这个几个前辈也讲到了这个，包括债券市场。如果按简单的这种传统上来讲的话，我们简单意义上来讲，可能我们债券市场只占了整个的融资里的20%，当然里头有发行机制，主体不一样啊，还有一个成熟过程。那由因为这一个市场没有完善起来。 带动了很多跟金融相关的，比如信用啊，比如说这个利率啊等等，这一些东西呢，都有这个被这个就是滞缓的这个可能。那么另外一个呢，就是说二级市场，我们讲到一级市场当里头，我们非常希望有序、公正这个有效。那么这个二级市场里头呢，大家也讲了，就实际上呢，我们的有合理的机构投资者，现在还是不，还是不，这是一个主力军。另外呢，我们有效的交易手段也不够。 所以从市场上交易手段上，从这个产品上，都有一个完善的过程。市场的结构，包括一级、二级。那么这个过程里头，我觉得呢，这个有的时候呢，当社会发展到一定程度的时候，一定要去遵循它的规律。当你失去规律而做一定的这种改革和变革的时候。 可能补了今天忘了明天，就是所谓的你我们以前讲过的顶层设计也好，总体设计也好，完善全部功能也好。那么另一个呢，就是说我们讲到就是呢，中国呢这个金融市场除了这个认真的这个遵循这个事物的发展规律这一特色之外呢，也确实呢还有另外一个呢，不能忘却了中国这个发展国情的一个实际。那这里头就获得的带出来了一个什么呢？创新的东西。那么因为前不久呢，我也跟一些经济学家好，这个还有一些搞金融的也聊过，就是如果简单意义的拿西方的一些理论实践经验呢，完整的来套现在呢，套不出来。但是反过来讲呢，我们自己创造出一些新的东西吗？也还没有。但这是呢，我觉得这是一个博弈的时候。我们这个整个的监管机构、从业者，当然包括这个投资者，都要有一个创新的东西在里头。所以有的时候呢，可能在历史的某个点上要有那么一点大胆的突破。我们现在可能是我觉得呢，香港相对来讲呢，监管的成本也高，监管的越严厉。实际上，如果把市场的它的功能完善化了，按规律的完善化了，大胆的做一些创新，总体而言来讲呢，包括我们国家的整个经济形态，从国企为主导的，像民企，就这么一个现象里头，照理来讲，就像血液似的，应该迅速的有一些导体出现了。要来培育，要来再生，要来辅助，所以这些的这个理念都应该在整个的监管和完善当中体现出来。
好，谢谢李总。那么李总呢？他讲的非常含蓄啊，因为他作为被这个中国证监会监管的一个金融企业，他不敢讲的太直白。但是呢，我们也听到了呢，确实企业呼吁呢，中国的这个证券市场的改革呢，可能还需要更大的突破。虽然我们的国日经主席已经做了大量的一些改革，但未来来看的突破还有很多。我们把这个突破的这个比较难的问题呢，交给我们的方兴海主任，因为他呢是在证券方面有非常多的经验，而且呢他现在管咱们上海的金融，而且上海呢又集中了中国几乎是最重要的最多的这个金融市场。方主任，
这个在这个代理市长和这个肖董事长面前谈金融改革啊，这个有点诚惶诚恐啊。我想呢这样，我呢就是把我聚焦的这个点呢给它缩小啊，我想把证券市场上的一个问题能够讲得稍微透彻一点。我就给大家提一个问题，我们这个股票市场啊，这个这么多年来啊，应该说没有给我们的普通投资者带来特别多的收益啊。最近香港这个金管局做了一篇很长的研究文章，我最近看了，他说自从2001年到2011年这十年之间，投资中国的股票市场的话呢，这个平均收益率呢是1.4%，应该说是低于我们的通胀啊，远远低。但是呢，中国呢是一个高增长的一个经济体，股票投资呢，应该说是或者股权投资吧，应该说是很赚钱的，是吧？这也是为什么这十几年来PE 啊，这些私募的 PE 啊，这个在中国投资啊，都是可以说赚的是盆满钵满，对吧？那么独独是投资二级市场的投资者啊，二级股票市场的投资者呢，是没有赚到钱。那么为什么会出现这个情况啊？这个，我想呢，是不是有这么三方面的这个原因？一方面呢，就是说我们的这个股票市场上啊，这个 IPO 这个过程啊，政府恐怕介入的还是太多了一点啊。这个过程呢，这个经常是受控的啊。比如说市场好的时候呢，它可能这个放出来的 IPO 呢，略微多一点，但是呢，也是这个供不应求啊，供应是不够的。那么所以 IPO 的价格就非常贵啊，在那个时候。
So the IPO is very expensive. When the market is in a low sentiment, 按道理 IPO
价格可以稍微低一点，对吧？
When the IPO price can be lower.
这个 IPO 的节奏又特别慢啊。那么造成总体的结果呢，就是 IPO 的价格特别高。
So its price is very high.
那么这样的话呢，就是说股权的收益呢，
It means
很大一部分的被一级市场就吃掉了
return,
到了二级市场投资的时候呢，
has been,
就没有什么太多可投资的空间了。
Absorbed by
这是不是一个原因？
Primary market,
我在想。
Well, there is not so much to
第二个原因是不是说
profit from in the secondary market?
我们这个股票市场呢，
Another、
总体来说是不是还是
thinking is that,
就是各种规章制度啊，是不是有点多、
？Maybe there are too many regulations.
使得呢，
over the market,
一些能够给普通投资者带来比较多收益的公司呢，它呢没有到我们这个市场上来上市。
Bring more profit to its investors
are not yet part of the market. 像腾讯啊, 对吧, 新浪啊,
companies like Sina,
百度啊, 这样的公司,
Tencent, and Baidu. Why don't they go public in domestic stock market? Why do they go public in overseas stock market? Maybe because they focus on the overseas market in the first place. So they went public in the stock market overseas. So I think maybe our domestic stock market lacks attraction for the domestic companies.
你看它的这个 ROE 啊, 就是净资产收益率啊,
ROE
也不低, 啊, 也挺好的,
is not very low for some companies.
但是呢,
However, the dividend
比较少, 啊,
is not very big.
一般性的观察都会认同的, 就是说, 我们的上市公司啊, 在分红方面啊,
Our public companies
普通的投资者, 特别是中小投资者,
should consider
带来回报方面的,
how to
这个压力呢, 不是特别大,
give more dividend or profit to the normal individual investors.
如果股价不涨啊, 通过分红的产生那个收益,
However, they do not suffer too much pressure in this regard.
我想是不是我, 我看也这么三方面的原因啊,
so they didn't pay too much attention to it.
想到其他的一些原因,
that's my
事实是摆在那的, 在一个高经济增长的, 那么一个,
and the fact is that in the stock market of a highly fast-developing economy, why are there so less, so few companies? Maybe the equity market reform can carry it out surrounding these areas. How can we bring down the IPO price? How can we attract more companies with strong growth potential? And how can we give more pressure to the market so that people pay more attention to the return to the small investors?
做一些其他的一些市场上的一些操作。
From the macro perspective, it covers a lot of aspects. Mr. Xiao and Mr. Dai all mentioned that. I read some articles and I heard some comments saying that our economy is slowing down, so that our financial reform can lead the whole economic reform. And it is an important engine for economic recovery. I agree to that. I think financial reform can play a leading role. However, we cannot rely on financial reform alone, because the economic reform as a whole is also a systematic engineering. In terms of monopoly in some sectors and IPR protection,
if
there are problems in those areas that haven't been addressed, it's very difficult to generate a lot of companies which can bring profit to its investors. And without these companies, the stock market reform cannot go very far.
Thank you, Mr. Fang. Let me interpret his thought.
He's saying that China's economy looked very good in the past. However, China's secondary market, in comparison, cannot be the leading indicator of its economy. Maybe our fundamentals are good, but there are some regulation or institutional design problems. So we should push forward reform in the three aspects he mentioned. I wonder whether Mr. Li Daokui has some different opinion, because he always disagrees with other people. I think we have discussed a lot about the financial reform in China, and the basic opinion is in consensus. Another field, the real estate, which plagued Chinese economy for a long time,
说明年能不能涨，后年能不能涨，在讨论这些问题，有可能啊，我不知道啊，跟各位请教，戴行长您请教，是不是搞金融的人的从业人员素质稍微高点，盖房子的人的素质低了一点，而这帮人现在都是发微博去了，就不讨论改革的问题了，我不知道，我只是提一个问题。这个话说回到这个金融体制改革以及股市的改革哈，我倒觉得啊，这个我完全同意这个这前几位的发言，我倒觉得可能需要抓住现在的这个宝贵的这个机遇啊，做一两件事情啊，做一两件对老百姓对这个经济的运行能够产生直接作用的一两件事情做出来啊，振奋一下改革的这个信心啊，给咱们这个改革的信心的提升一步，所以这也是金融改革的一个使命了。那几件事情，我想两件事情可以做，对吧？其实也是思路跟他们一致的。第一呢是银行改革。在我看来啊，中国经济、中国金融的这个最大的风险还是在银行。
I think the biggest risk
啊，这个肖董事长，我知道你们银行搞得不错，但是总体而言，你看咱们的金融资产。是吧？122万亿吧，没搞错吧？银行资产占 GDP 两倍，200%以上，对吧？这个股市现在搞了半天，就股票价格跌，也就是市值，也就是占 GDP 60%-70%吧。债券市场接近50%，债券市场不错啊，这个很争气的，最近搞得不错，53%是吧？你刚刚最新的数字，所以重大风险还是银行，所以我觉得还是应该呀。这个针对银行进行一些改革，怎么改革？这我这个最近写的篇文章，今年三月份在政协提了搞了一个提案，就是加快这个银行的资产的证券化，就是把一部分的银行的成熟的资产卖到股票、债券市场去，而且呢，要求这个银行之外的投资者，比如说社保基金来买，对吧？这么一个运作有什么战略意义呢？通过这个运作，短期来讲，对吧？它能够让银行的在融资的压力减小，让股市的股民能够放心啊，这个是相对而言比较小的一个好处。大的好处是什么？大的好处是让银行的资产转移到债券市场，把债券市场搞大，把银行相对资产规模弄小一点，银行可以轻装上阵，银行可以更加把它的精力放在寻找新的更好的投资项目上去，包括中小企业，对吧？这件事如果做的话，它能够直接的改善咱们的金融结构，把债券市场进一步做大。我想希望能够在不远的将来啊，明后年我们债券市场的规模能够超过股市。当然我也希望股市价格能涨，股市的这个市场的这个市值也能上升，是吧？这是一件事，如果能干的话，能够提升我们的信心。第二件事，
Another thing that we can do，
这个股市价格的下降的的确确现在是一个社会问题啊，已经超出了经济的范畴。我讲的非常坦率，甚至于是政治问题，是吧？股民是很厉害的，是吧？股民发帖子、发微博是很凶的，是吧？这就是讲，必须要从治标到治本，各个方面同时要入手。那么治标的办法是什么呢？治标当然 IPO 要适当的放缓。IPO 不能搞太多，治标的办法也包括，比如说动员一部分长期的基金啊，这资金能够投入到这个股市上去。治标的办法也包括什么呢？也包括比如讲，适当的把股市债券化，什么意思？要求你强行的要求你要分红，你只要赚了钱，你给我分红啊。通过这个方式，让股民不用太依赖内部信息。直接的从这个分红中间获得长期持有股票的好处了。当然，这都是治标的办法，是吧？治本的办法是什么呢？我始终在想，这个方兴海这个我们老同学了，他那个问题问得很好。为什么中国的股市20多年了搞不好？本质上讲，中国的治本
没说20多年来搞不好这事儿。
他读的一篇文章吧，咱们。
At least that's what he said in one article.
肯定不好啊！诸位，你们说说看，是不是？你连存银行的钱都打不过那个利息率，是不是啊？肯定是不好，这没什么好争的，是吧？为什么搞不好？因为中国的制度出的实在是不适合于股票市场的发展。股市和债市，股市跟投资于银行有什么不一样？它的表面的约束力是没有的。我把钱投资于一个上市公司，它可以跟我永远再见，永远不理我了。 没有约束，不像那个债券可以定期的给我发利息，对吧？那么过去二十年，国际金融界的一个可能最重要的研究成果之一，这个研究成果一般认为能得诺贝尔奖以后啊，就是发现什么呢？发现影响股市是否健康的最重要的因素是法治。
Actually, the rule of law is the one single factor that
have
the biggest impact on the stock market development. However, in China, people are affected by emotion and sometimes policies.
So the
legal system relating to the stock market is very weak. The local government, to some extent, interfere with the legal cases of public companies in their localities. So I call on that in big cities such as Beijing or Shanghai or Shenzhen, establish a securities court,
and
all the irregularities of a public
companies
will be handled not in traditional court or local court.
直接啊，这个按照最高的、严格的按照证券法、严格的按照公司法去打官司，抓一两个案件，你不需要严打，你就严格按照你的规矩办事嘛。通过这样子的办法，一方面能够提振信心，啊，提振国际、国内投资者的信心，是吧？另一方面呢，也能够推动我们的法治建设，是吧？实实在在的能够把法治文化、法治的理念能够贯彻到老百姓的心中去，通过股民。
A norm in people's hearts, and we can rely on the stock market investors to educate the public about the relevant laws and regulations. I think if we can achieve that, the finance reform will be very active.
在讲到把所有的这个大的案子都放到上海去打的时候呢，方主任面带微笑。
So Mr. Fang smiled when Mr. Li said he should transfer all the cases to Shanghai and to the securities court.
应该会有一些时间呢留给我们的。
And we will leave some time later on for Q&A session. But before that, I have two quick questions because we still have two important topics to cover. One is for Mr. Xiaogang.
我们要还是要谈一谈人民币国际化。
We still have to talk about internationalization of RMB. Mr. Dai has already mentioned, based on the current data, in the big market around the world, in the foreign exchange transaction, RMB accounts for less than 1%. However, in the letter of credit issuance, RMB accounts for over 10%, ranking number three. It's a number three ranking currency in the world. So BOC has great potential in this regard.Can you put in some insight for us?
因为人民币呢还不是一个储备货币。
This is very normal because.
那么最近两年呢，加快了人民币的这个贸易结算，所以在这个信用证啊这个结算工具上呢，现在发展很快。去年大概已经超过两万多亿这个结算，那么今年上半年也超过了一万多亿人民币结算。所以呢，但是呢，在这个货币交易当中，人民币的。用的人民币还非常少，对，可能就
20%是not that much, but if in the transaction market,
RMB cannot have a deposit, RMB cannot be internationalized. 所以这下面就涉及到刚才代理市场提到的资本向下可兑换。所以你要加快资本向下可兑换，真正使人民币成为一种投资的货币，一个储藏的货币，
you should make RMB a reserve currency,
占的比重就会上来了。
And then the proportion of RMB could be improved, but there is a still long way ahead. Let me add one point. I agree definitely the points made by Mr. Xiao.
就是说，人民币国际化呢，一段时间呢，我们国内啊也没有形成足够的共识。现在我看这个共识比较强烈了哈。
Consensus in China in the past, but now the consensus is there. This is pretty good. With the consensus, the next job is that we develop our security market, we make our interest rate market based, we do our work in terms of free conversion, etc. If indeed it's market based. cost is very flexible, then it's a big support for the internationalization of RMB. Then other central banks and traders and investors would be very ready to use RMB to transact. Now, how can they use RMB? Because the market is not developed and there are so much regulation. So I think we still focus on our own preparation domestic work. Thank you very much. One more question for Mr. Dai. If we look at the financial reform framework, especially the top design around the world, we talk about the macro and the micro prudence. At the end of this year, UK has breaked through all regulations for banks will be in the hands of the central bank, and the European is talking about a single
那么在美国呢,
regulatory, which could be ECB in the US, the Federal Reserve is a big
regulator
and regulating more banks, but in China, we still have People's Bank of China and the banking committee. Now, Mr. Dai, as an independent observer, and also you were former president of People's Bank of China, do you think these two institutions should be integrated and merged?
我先说你一个，就刚才李教授说的一个问题。
Well, let me first respond to what Professor Lee mentioned. The security market is, if we develop this market, we could serve several purposes. First, we can increase asset, and second, it will help the RMB to be internationalized. If we develop the security market, then the liquidity would be increased. So it could be a concern, but it could be also a focal point. I think the State Council leaders already mentioned this, that first of all, you acknowledge the situation. This is a situation from the past.
But
let's align among ourselves. I think the hope is already there. The question is, one, can we implement the policies? Just, I think the security market is very important point for us to focus on. And financial regulation is already an old topic. We have insurance industry, we have financial industry, etc. Big companies need loans and need insurance. The Communication Bank adopted comprehensive mode because they think it's a general trend.
跟我讲的全是不是银行的事，全是讲资本市场，对吧？
Some foreign gas from banks, but actually to talk about topics which are not related to banks. I think we should provide comprehensive service, diversified service. But how do we monitor, how do we regulate if it's a comprehensive service?
No.
The UK adopted a model which the central bank was separated. Actually, we think it's pretty good to set up an independent financial service bureau. It's a good practice. But now we heard that we have merged the two institutions. So I think we should make our own decisions instead of looking at other countries. I think currently we have separate institutions. But overall, the management capacity has been improved. However, it's more difficult for us to coordinate with the two separate institutions. So a very important point is to do like this. You know, we have the Securities Committee, we have the Banking Security Insurance Committee. Sometimes I take part in meetings with representatives from other committees. For example, Zhou Xiaochuan always insists that the meetings should be held in the People's Bank of China. You know, we had records for our meetings, and whatever problems we think we have a frank discussion about these problems. I think we are a little bit clear about the way ahead. I mean, the pattern is already here. Let's not argue about this. Let's think about the way forward. I think we can do this. So my proposal is that the regulatory system is not the problem. The system is important, but coordination is more important. So what matters is coordination. Now the floor is open. You can raise any questions or comments. The lady over there, first, please identify yourself. Please be brief. Thank you very much. I'm from Wang Yi. I'm Wang Yi. My question is for Mr. Xiao. Since January next year, there would be new capital reserve ratio. What impact do you think it will have on the capital adequacy ratio? Whether the current adequacy ratio can satisfy next 3 years development? Thank you for your question. Since next January, the new
rule would take effect.
It will definitely have impact, but not that huge impact. First, the majority of the banks already have satisfied this requirement. Specifically, Bank of China, as I mentioned, the capital ratio, adequacy ratio is over 13%. The core capital is over
10%. 是达标的,
so we're up to the standard. Actually, we exceed
那么,
the standard or requirement.
所以呢, 我觉得是不会有很多的冲击的。 第二一个呢, 就是我们这个新的资本协议,
and second, the new agreement would last till the beginning of
2019.
Transition period will exist till the beginning of 2019 or the end of 2018. So we have a long transition period. For some banks whose capital adequacy ratio is not high yet, they still have time to work on that. Thank you very much. Another question. How about let's have one gentleman ask a question?
前面这一位。 对，也还是请你非常的简短。
Could you please make your question very brief?
I'm from Tianjin Daily News.
对不起，只有一个问题。 Just one question, please.
那我先提给那个代理市长。
Okay, my question is for Mr. Dai.
他刚才谈到一个利率市场化的问题。
Mr. Dai mentioned the market-based interest rate, but close to the topic is about the insurance system. In July, the People's Bank of China issued a report thinking that the time is ready, which means the coverage of the insurance and some other factors. We have been clear with these factors. If not, what's your proposals? Actually, I do not know more than you do, because I do not work in the People's Bank of China, but I really take this new rule from the People's Bank of China very seriously, I think. Well, the insurance of saving is a very important mechanism. I definitely support this. When I was the president, I studied about this. Some people are concerned that whether the insurance of the saving could mean some moral risks for those banks offering this kind of insurance. Well, I do not agree with this concern. But definitely some people, very silly people, I think, can think in this way. And also the insurance mechanism is another challenge. Some small and medium banks are very active because they have more risks. For example, Bank of China may not be that active. But in the future, I'm not sure. I think maybe the insurance mechanism changes with the risks. If the risk is higher, then the premium could be higher. And vice versa. So I think the insurance mechanism for the saving is necessary. And
Bank of China
is very prudent. They say we can study this. That means they will study this.
好，谢谢李市长给我们国内央行的这个报告的一个重要的一个视角。我们再回到这个这边来，请我们这位前台的这位男生，估计也是一位记者。您好，我是来自新华社。
您好，我是来自新华社的记者。我想问一下方兴海，就是问题非常的简单，国际版开不开？如果要加入亚太自贸，到底开不开？这个希望因为这次来到现场的有很多国内外的投资者，就是说，之前海外声音也比较大，现在的声音慢慢小下来，这块怎么看？这个问题很难啊。
我呢，平时呢，这个对外的一些大事情，他们的不断的来，这个聊天上海是正好。我总是跟他们说，我说这个前途是光明的啊，道路是曲折的。为什么呢？这个国际版这个事呢，是写到国务院关于上海国际金融中心建设的这个十九号文件当中去的，2009年写进去的。那么我想这个事情呢，我相信呢，这是中国开放的这个推进啊。
所以我们改革的这个进程是要推出的，但是呢，这个国际版这个事呢是写到国务院关于上海国际金融中心建设的这个十九号文件当中去的。2009年写进去的，那么我想这个事情呢，我相信就是说，我作为上海金融办主任，我还真是没有任何这个内部的信息可以，就是说提供给你们，但是我希望你们呢，自己的准备工作呢，要这个继续做啊，比如说一些承销商啊，你就可以早点确定下来，然后呢，帮你准备情况，对吧？也要经常跟这个中国证监会沟通嘛。
中国来的时候呢，也争取能够去拜访啊，这个中国证监会的领导等等，所以这些事情呢，我都是鼓励他们的这个继续做啊。那么，我们国家呢，我的观察是，就是过去三十年，我们国家经济发展当中有一个，我觉得好像有一个规律似的，就是我们的经济发展呢，增速啊减缓的时候呢。
我们对开放的这个加快，加快。
When we joined WTO, the backdrop, I remember we had the negotiation, we finished the negotiation in 1990.
In the 90s,
every round of negotiation will pave the way for the next round of development. So I think for the launch of the international market or bond, I just want to say that be positive, do your preparation. Thank you, Mr.
My understanding is that in the future we will have this international market, but when exactly will we have this? You have to ask Premier Wen Jiabao or you ask
问他未来要问他这件事儿是如何做。我们因为时间的缘故，就是没法再继续了。我们最后呢，是要让潘总监要总结一下我们论坛。我是想请我们五位的嘉宾呢，用一句话来回答这个我的两个问题。第一个问题呢，是说中国的这个金融未来五年最大的风险是什么？第二个呢，是说您认为最急迫的这个金融危机，我们从
最大的风险就是抓不住机遇，但我看来还是股市的改革。中国证券市场一定要做好它的全方位的，而不是可以在阶段当中可以是有替代性的和短效的一些功能。但是呢，整体的格局，否则的话，刚才我们讲的债券市场，那么你刚才讲未来几年突破口，它会引领着好几个功能的产生。
Definitely is a breakthrough. Thank you very much, Mr. Fang. I think the biggest risk is that the economic growth dropped dramatically because of some unforeseen reasons. Then there would be many financial risks. Then how do we maintain stable and fast economic growth in the next 5 years? It's a great challenge. And this goes back to financial reform.
Market-based
reform, if this kind of reform can be adopted, this will definitely motivate or boost the economic growth. Thank you very much, Mr. Next, I think the biggest risk is shadow banking market or system.
This
is very closely related with the risks in the banking market, but also to the risk of the capital market. In the next stage, we should reform the capital market and the security market. Thank you very much, Mr. Dai.
Well, financial reform
is a long process.
We
have to have a quantitative change which leads to qualitative change. Currently, the financial industry in China has exposed the most urgent risk, which may cause panic, but the debt increases is 5% more than the capital increase. This is a risk.
But
at this moment, I think the equity market is the priority, and also the interest rate reform is irreversible. As you may know, the central bank in China has changed the interest rate for saving and
They say that
the deposit interest should increase by 10%, and the loan interest rate should be brought down. Otherwise, I will not borrow from your commercial bank anymore. And when corporate bonds are issued, the deposit will be less, and the securitization will happen. So we cannot wait for 10,000 years. We have to seize the current time. China's financial reform has already achieved a lot, but we should not be reckless. In the long term, we should start step by step to address the market-oriented interest rate first and the stock market reform first. So some key findings from this panel, one is that the quality of the financial professionals is higher than that in the real estate market. And second, the financial reform cannot succeed on its own. We need some real economy reform to go with it. And the third, the biggest risk for us is not to reform. And the second is the securities market risk. And the urgent things we have to do, one is the market-based interest rate, the other is the stock market reform, securities market reform. And also we have to have some top design, and we have to seize the time. So thank you all for participation. I hope that we can see you in the future. Thank you.